Sorry. Let me make one comment about the WebAssign problems or the polar area problems. I keep getting these emails. It's important, it's critical, that you think about what the integral represents. So that if you're finding you have some function in polar coordinates that looks like this, and I want to find this area, I have to remember that when I do a polar integral, I'm adding up things that look like this. And so you really have to think about what the integral represents geometrically. So for example, there's a problem where you're supposed to find the area between two circles that overlap like this. It is, if you just write integrate from where the two things intersect to where the two things intersect, and take the squares and subtract, you get zero. Because really what you're finding is you integrate from here to here, and you get this area minus this area. Well, they're equal, so then you get zero. So this problem, which probably a lot of you have not done, so you don't have a clue what I'm talking about. If you solve, so this is like r equals cosine theta, r equals sine theta. So I'm not telling you how to do it, just telling you what not to do. If you solve where these two things equal, then you get theta is pi over 4, or theta is 5 pi over 4. And if you just do something silly, like write the integral from pi over 4 to 5 pi over 4, 1 half cosine squared theta minus sine squared theta, the answer is 0. That's not the answer to this question. And that's because what this represents is the area, cosine squared, this area, minus this area, well, it's 0. Just think about what's going on. Okay, so let's move back to infinite series or infinite sums. So, as I said before, I will try to say the word sum instead of series. The book does not use the word sum, it uses the word series, don't be confused. The reason I prefer to use the word sum is because it means adding. Series means something slightly different in English than it means in math. So, anyway. So last time, we saw that if we have something like this, where r is a number, an absolute value less than 1, this is a geometric series, geometric series. So this is 1 plus r, r squared, r cubed, and on forever. So what we saw last time is that this adds up to that. So that means that if we see something that looks like say, I don't know, 4 minus, let me just look at these already, 8, 16, 32. 8 thirds plus 16 ninths minus 32 27ths plus, what's next? 64 81sts minus blah blah blah. What would you see? How would I do this? We're not using the clicker, so I can't ask this as a clicker question, but that doesn't mean you get off from thinking. Somebody tell me how to do this problem. Yeah. Okay, so what do you see as the pattern? Okay. What's the numerator look like? Two to the n? Well, but it's not every two to the n. I mean, you're close. No, it's not two to the 2n. Yeah?
2 to the 2n plus 2.
Okay, sure. Anything else? This is not what this equals. We're close.
There's a negative.
There's a negative. So is it this?
Also, does it matter if you start like 0 or 1?
Well, of course it matters. But so let's just try and figure out what it is, and then we'll turn it into something that looks like this. So this is not right. What's wrong with this? Okay, or I can just, all right. So if I, you're saying do that.
Yeah.
Does that work? And what does n start? 0? So if n is 0, we have positive 4, when n is 1, we have minus 8 over 3. So that seems to work. So, okay. Now this doesn't look like that. But how can we make this look like that? Or do we have any hope of making this look like that? So what's the problem with this? Why doesn't this look like that? Yeah. Right. So how can I turn them into being the same power? Yeah. You moved over here. What's wrong with you? Find a place and sit there. No, sorry. Fine. So go ahead.
You could make 4 into minus 2 times n. You could split the power.
Split the power, right. So that's a good idea. So write this as. So factor out this is power 2. So that I have minus 2 to the 2 times minus 2 to the n over 3 to the n. Right? That's what you were saying, I hope? Okay. So then that is, well, minus 2 to the n is 4. And it's 4 times every single term, so I can just factor the 4 out. Playing around with this stuff, I can factor each term out. Now, if you're more comfortable working with the initial thing, you can factor the 4 out of everything up there first. Notice that the first term is not a 1, factor the 4 out of everything. So if you prefer, you could also write this as 4 times 1 minus 2 thirds plus 4 ninths minus 8 27ths plus 16 81sts. Minus blah blah blah. So I just factoring the 4 out of this, I get that. So however I manipulate it, it's the same thing. So now this is easy. So what is this sum? The formula's on the board. It's just a matter of noticing and plugging in. How many of you are planning to major in engineering? Okay, so you should be really good at looking at formulae you know and manipulating them and turning them into specific applications. Engineers do that a lot. So, what is this sum? What are you engineers? Come on.
3/5.
How do you get that?
Are you doing 1/1?
Yeah.
That's 1/1.
Okay, so that's 3/5. Why is that wrong? Because it's times 4. So it's 12/5. It's close. The bridge fell down, but okay. It's close. It looked nice before it fell down. Okay, so these kinds of things, they're not, so horrible. So it consists of a lot of looking at it, manipulating it, turning it into something that you know, and going from there. Notice that we can also do something like if I had, maybe, what if it doesn't start at 0? Suppose I have something like, let's just do the same one. N equals 4 to infinity of minus 2/3. Well, let's do it again. 1/5 to the n. What can I do with this? So this starts at n equals 4. So this begins, I don't even know, 1 over 5 to the 4th plus 1 over 5 to the 5th plus blah blah. Yeah?
Could you first take the sum from 0 to infinity and then subtract the sum from...
Okay, you could do that.
Wonderful.
So this is the same as n equals 0 to infinity of 1 over 5 to the n minus the sum, let me just write it, minus the first 3 terms, 4 terms, 1 plus a 5th plus... 25th plus 1/25th. So you could do that. So that's, I guess I'll write it over here, is the same as 1/5 to the n, so that's 1 over 1 minus a 5th, which is 5/4, minus some junk that I don't want to add. So it's 5/4. Minus whatever that junk is. Did I do that right? 4/5, 5/4, yeah, so it's that. Another way you could do it, which is a little easier for me to actually do the arithmetic, what's another way?
A is your first term, so you're collecting 4 for n, 1/5 to the n.
Wait, say that again?
A is your first term.
Yeah.
So your first term here is 4, so you're collecting n to 4, 1/5 to the 4 to the first term. That over 1 minus 1.
Okay, yeah. So, in other words, factor out the first term. Right? So this is the same thing as 1 over 5 to the 4th times 1 plus a 5th plus 5th squared plus blah, blah, blah. So this is 1 over 5 to the 4th. Now this is the standard geometric sum. This is 1 over 5 to the 4th times 1 over 1 minus 5th, which is whatever the heck it is. 1 over 5 to the 4th times 5/4 is whatever that is. 1 over 125 times 4. Okay? So, I don't want to spend the whole class doing this kind of nonsense, but you should get comfortable with manipulating these things and playing around with them. Okay, so that's one thing we did last time. Another thing we did last time was the harmonic series. This is a very important fact, which is... this diverges. So even though it looks like it should converge, it looks like it should add up to something, in fact, it gets as large as you like. And the way I show that is by grouping the terms and noticing that I can make them, like computing the partial sums, and then noticing that I can make them as large as I want. They just get large slowly. So I'll come back to this later. I'll prove it a different way in a minute, or around a minute, several minutes. So let's look at some other kinds of series. So let's think about when we're thinking of an infinite sum. So let's look at an example like say n squared over 5n squared plus 8. And you can start anywhere. How about 0? Should this converge or diverge? And how can we tell? So he thinks it should converge. Yes? Right. So it actually diverges. Why is it diverge? So for n really big, this looks like one over a fifth. Well, looks like fifth plus fifth plus fifth plus fifth plus fifth. Right? In other words, so what this squishy statement for n really big, I guess I can just move over here, that is, the limit as n goes to infinity of n squared over 5n squared plus 8 is a fifth. And so when I start writing down the terms, I'm not even going to write the first several. So when n is 0, that's easy. That's 0. And when n is 1, that's a 13th. And then there's a lot of stuff that I want to leave off. And then I wait until about the millionth term, and it's something. Fifth is 0.2, so 0.2 some stuff. 0.2 some stuff. 0.2 some stuff. And so on. And there's infinitely many of these things. So you add up a lot of 0.2s, you get a very big number. So more generally, this tells us that if, well, in this example, this is not a proof, but it's easy to prove. If, it doesn't matter what we sum over, if we have an infinite sum like this converges, then for sure, the limit of the an, as n goes to infinity, has to be 0. Or to say it another way, if the limit of the term is not 0, well, let's say not 0. Let's say there is a limit. So the limit of the term is not 0, then this must diverge. Now it's important to realize that doesn't mean if the limit is 0, then for sure it converges. Right? It's only saying if it's not 0, then it diverges. Right? Is this clear? Clear to her because she already knew it. Is anyone confused about this? Okay. So what we're saying is if the terms don't get small, when you add a lot of them, you get it big. If I start adding a lot of things, each of which is not teeny tiny, then I get a lot of stuff. The only way that I can add infinite amounts of things together and have something finite is if they get small. Right? That's what this says. Yeah?
I understand that it looks like if you can see how an H can be out of
I don't care about the 8 when n is 1,000. So when n is 1,000, I have 1,000 squared over 5,000 squared or 5 times 1,000 squared plus a little tiny number. It's a lot, that's good. I mean, it's 0.2, actually 0.1999999999. Very close to a fifth. So, you know, if we're talking about 50 cents in the federal budget, nobody knows. Or even, you know, you go to the grocery store and you buy a candy bar, they don't even bother with the payment. The same thing here. This is a penny. This is $10. Or $100. Okay. So one fact here is that when we add infinitely many things together, ultimately those things have to be tiny. And they have to be as tiny as we want if we want it to add up to something. Let me turn to another example. Okay, something like this. So, I mean, part of what I'm doing right now is I'm just putting a bunch of examples up and I'm messing around with them and showing that we can do something. We'll turn to developing some theory pretty soon. But suppose I have something like this. So this is, so when n is 1, I get a half. When n is 2, I get a fifth. When n is 3, 6. 1 over 4 plus 2, you're right, a 6. When n is 3, I get 9 plus 3 is 12. When n is 4, I get 16 plus 4 is 20, and so on. Is there anything I can do here? Notice that it has a chance of converging because the limit as n goes to infinity of this is 0. So it has a chance. Maybe it converges, maybe it doesn't. How could we see that it converges? In fact, I can see what it adds up to. If it adds up to 1. Yeah? Well, if I replaced everything with 1/6, then I would get an infinite number. Right? So if I replaced everything with 1/6, I would have 1/2 plus as many sixths as I like. Well, then that would show it would diverge. Is that what you're saying? So you're saying replace these with the sixth, and then replace these with the sixth. Okay, that trick's going to fail. You can try it. It's not going to work. So I can tell you at the beginning that this converges. It isn't obvious that it does converge. But it's obvious if you know how to do this stuff. It's not obvious. It shouldn't be obvious yet, except for you refugees from 127. Okay, so it's not obvious even what to do here. So a trick is... we can use partial fractions. Remember those? So, maybe we can do something by rewriting these in a clever way. So if we have that, so that means that A times n plus 1 plus B times n equals 1, right, using partial fractions. Which we use for integration. And so this means that we have A plus B is 0, because I have an n here, no n here. And A is 1. So B, right? A is 1. So B is minus 1. So that means 1 over n squared plus n is the same thing as 1 over n minus 1 over n plus 1. And so now, I guess I'll go back over here. Using that, I can rewrite this this way. Right, so those are the same by algebra. So now if we start writing out some terms, the first term is 1 minus and then the next term is 1/2 minus 1/3. And then the next term is 1/3 minus 1/4. And then the next term is 1/4 minus 1/5. And so on. And notice what's happening. I take 1/2, I throw a little bit away. I take 1, I throw a little bit away. Then I add that little bit back again, and I throw away a different amount. Then I add that amount back, and I throw away a different amount, and so on. So this is 1, and if I group these together, I get nothing. And if I group these together, I get nothing. And if I group these together, I get nothing. So this is 1. This is called a telescoping series. Or maybe telescopic, I don't know. And it should be like, you know, in the pirate movies when they take out their thing, and then they close it up again. So this expands into a big thing, which you can just collapse. So this trick or technique works sometimes, but not all that often. Okay? So, once in a while, it's going to be a handy thing. Now, usually, finding the sum is not so important. Sometimes it is. Finding it exactly is not so important. What's important is knowing whether it does have one or not. So a lot of our focus won't necessarily be on when these things add up, what do they add up to? Because I can use a computer to do that. If I want to know what this adds up to, I can find it to 1,000 decimal places by just running a computer for a little while. But if it doesn't add up, I'll get a nonsense answer. So the real question, a lot of times, is not what is the sum, but is there one? So almost more important than what the sum is should I even bother to look? Important. it's not only less important, it's also harder. Well, it's harder to get exact and not so hard to approximate. And so this is a very important question. So a lot of times we'll just focus on, does this converge? Yes, no. And another thing that's important is to be able to convince somebody that you're not just flipping a coin and saying, yeah, it converges. So you have to be able to justify your answer. So, see, this is already an important thing. If the limit of the nth term is not zero, then it doesn't converge. We're done. We already have one of these kinds of things. And let's work on developing a couple others. So, and let's work on it with a specific example. So we already saw with a fair amount of work that the harmonic series, sum of 1 over n, does not converge. Let's look at the one I started with. Sum of squares. This is 1 plus a quarter plus a ninth plus 16. So on. Now, does this converge? It has a hope. It has a hope of converging because certainly the terms go to zero. It also has a hope of converging because it looks kind of like this one. It looks a lot like 1 over n squared plus n. So, and in fact, just using this fact, that one is, well, it's not quite good enough, right? So this looks like, whatever this means, and I'll make this precise in a few minutes, well, no, probably next week. And if we just didn't have this stupid end there, then it would be good. And we know this one. Is 1. So we would expect that probably this converges. But expecting that probably it converges is not good enough. We have to know that it converges. So how can we maybe know that this converges? Notice that we can't say, well, every term here is less than one of these, because actually these are smaller. Right? This guy is still here. The first term there is 1, the first term here is a half. The second term there is a quarter, this term is a sixth. So I can't say, well, this one's bigger than that one, so it squashes it down. Because actually that one's bigger than this one. But they're kind of related. So this, the trick of directly comparing isn't going to work. So, we have to try something else. So what do we do a lot in this class? What have we been doing all semester? Integrating. Maybe integrals will have something useful to tell us. So let's draw a picture. Well, let me draw a picture. You don't have to draw a picture. I'm going to draw a picture, and I'm going to think about what that picture is telling me. Let's take a bunch of rectangles of width 1, and height 1 over n squared for the various values of x. So I'm going to draw it bigger than it is. So here is a rectangle of height from 0 to 1 of height 1. And then next to it is a rectangle, which I'll put between 1 and 2, of height 1 over 2 squared. And then next to it, I will put a little rectangle of height 1 ninth. And then I will put a little rectangle of height 1 16th. Already my scale is off, but I have a bunch of rectangles that look like this. Why did I do this? I don't know, because it's math class and we do weird stuff in math class. What do we know about this area? What function is it related to?
Well, not 1 over x squared.
Right? What have I done? This point, this point, this point, this point, this point, this point, all live on some curve. They live on the curve y equals 1 over x squared. This area here is certainly less than some integral. What integral? Somebody said it. Yes, less than the integral 1 over x squared from 1 to infinity. So it's less than, I guess I can write it here, the integral, well you can't see it if I write it. The integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx. Well, we already dealt with those kinds of things. Well, we did it. Some people got it right. So we know that, I'll put it in quotes, we should know that the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx, this is the limit as m goes to infinity of that integral, which is a number. So this is, why can't I do it? X to the minus 2, so that's 1 over x negative from 1 to m limit. So that's 1. So we know for sure it's less than 1. So we know then that this adds up, and it adds up to something less than 1. Now if we want to figure out what it adds up to, you can just take out your computer and start adding, and you get a lower bound. I'm sorry? Oh yeah, somewhere I screwed up, didn't I? Where did I screw up? Oh, because I did 0 to 1. No? What did I do wrong? Oh, shoot. It's certainly bigger than 1, isn't it? Yeah, that's okay. No. y equals 1 over x squared. This is certainly less. Oh, I see. Yes, stupid. Notice that the integral here, I started at 1, so this rectangle wasn't included in the integral. The integral is this area, but my sum has a 1 more. The integral only gives me this part. All right? People see that? So it's less than 2, thank you. It's close. But it's certainly convergent. And in fact, if we want to get that it's bigger than something, we could put the boxes on the other side. But, right? So, draw this picture. The sum is an approximation of the integral, and it's from underneath. Let's, in the picture, if f of x is decreasing, then the sum less than f of 1 plus this integral. Okay? So the sum and the integral are closely related. But it goes the other way too. If the integral does not converge, neither will the sum. So let's look at that. So let me do for one that we know diverges. And then I'll say it again
in a nicer way.
One that we know divergence. So we already know the sum of 1 over n diverges. We already did that by cleverly putting terms together. Let's compare that. We also know that the integral, well, I hope we know, that this diverges too. Do this integral, you get the log and the limit as x goes to infinity of the log is not zero, it flows up, it's infinite. Right, so we did this before in class, I don't know, a month ago. We saw that this diverges. Does everyone remember that? Well, let's relate these by picture again, but not the same picture. So here's the graph. Y equals 1 over x. Let's put the points, well, my scale is off, but I don't care. Here are the points 1, 1 half, 1 third, 1 fourth, and so on. And let's, again, put little rectangles on there. We don't have to start our little rectangles at 0. Let's just shift them over by 1. Let's put them here. So now I'm putting the rectangles on the other side. So this area is bigger than the integral. But what is this area? Each of these I'm choosing to be 1y. So this is 1 plus this area is a half, this area is a third, this area is a fourth, and so on. That's my sum. So, by thinking about it this way, we see that the sum of 1 over n is bigger than the integral of 1 over x. Because I put the sum on the other side, the integral pushes it up. And this is infinite. Now, I didn't prove this, but you can turn this into like a real mathematical proof. But let me just restate it the same way. So this is something called the integral test. Let me just make sure I didn't leave out something. So let's write it a little more carefully. So f of x is a continuous decreasing function, and positive. Okay, so we have a continuous decreasing function f of x, and we have f of n equals a of n. In other words, that's what our series is made up of. Then, if the integral, and it doesn't matter where you start, from somewhere to infinity, of f of x dx converges, so does the sum. If the integral of f of x dx diverges, so does the sum. Well, this is sort of the story that we've seen. I see where I'm coming. This is the story that we've seen from the beginning. Integrals are just special sums. So if this infinite, if this improper integral converges, so does that. If it diverges, so does that. Okay, well, I'll see you Monday. Have a nice weekend.